So, yeah, so could you all hear me? I have Stephen, I have Kyle, I have Elizabeth. Right, we'll start. So I'm going to start with this particular one. Well, you know, I have an older version of the book. I do have the new book here. You know, and it's pretty much the same thing, right? So there are two learning outcomes in chapter five. We have marine transport and you have land transport. So we can get it from there. Because it's an hour and a half, it's kind of easy. So I would not explain because if I explain, we'll be finished in half an hour time. So I'll go through the reading today, right? If I say around 2 o'clock, we still haven't finished. I would just kind of explain anyway. But I'll go through the reading because it is that simple anyway, right? If you have the pages in the book, it's not that much. So I actually did this in I think 1 hour time in Guyana, right? So I'll make a start. So just give me a verbal prompt. So can you all hear me on your side? Those who
Yes,
are on
sir.
there. Okay, good. So I'll start it, right? So
That's
marine
it. Yes, sir.
transport. Okay, good. Marine transport. I don't want to read everything, but as we start in, we'll read, right? So I have here, I think the book having it, Marine Transport, Hazards of Vessels and Working Over Water. That's on page 3. So let me see. You know, if we could line that up anyway, right? But certification approval. It's about the same start, right? If I look at the book here, they have the first thing is the different types of floating platforms. I may have missed that, did I? Yeah, so it's right here. Hazards of vessels. And so it's the same thing. It's the same thing, right? So I probably had gone to the page below. So the offshore industry, the offshore oil and gas industry uses a vast array of marine vessels and structures, ranging from the large floating oil rig and oil tankers to small survival craft. The floating production, storage, and offloading vessel performs the key function of, and that's the FPSO. I have seen questions on these things, but I think the hazards are kind of all the same. But we'll see it in a bit, right? Because they have it in the book here anyway, right? So the FPSO performs a key function of receiving hydrocarbon produced from nearby platforms, processing them, storing them, offloading them via a tanker or a pipeline. FPSOs are often converted oil tankers or maybe vessels built specifically for the application. And anyway, I'll keep reading, right? Other vessels may perform a more limited range of functions such as floating storage and offloading unit. FSOs use only to store oil and offload to oil tankers. Floating storage unit used to transfer oil by pipeline to the land-based facility. Similar vessels, FSRU, floating storage and regasification units are used to store and handle liquefied natural gas. They receive LNG from other vessels, convert the liquid back into a gas, and distribute via pipeline to onshore facilities. Guess I'll go on this side, right? So you have a glossary of terms here. We have FSOs, floating storage and offloading unit, a floating hull fitted with oil storage tanks and a facility to transfer oil to tankers. Many FSOs are all converted super tankers. FSU, floating storage unit can either be the same as an FSO, floating storage and offloading unit. Or more commonly, transfer the oil by pipeline to land-based facilities. FPSOs are very common for exam. This one, floating production, storage, and offloading unit for receiving crude oil from wells, processing it, separation of the oil, water, oil, gas, and water, storing and offloading. So the hazards come from that, right? If you understand those things, the hazards could come from each part of that application then, right? Chemical spills. Oil spills, but we'll see it in a bit, right? So LNG, FSRU, liquefied natural gas, floating storage and regasification unit, receive LNG from other vessels, regasifies it, right? Convert the liquid back to a gas and distribute it via pipelines to onshore facilities. So, as well as the intrinsic dangers associated with planned operations on board and beneath such vessels, there are the specific issues of, and yeah, geez, you know, like I was telling you all, the Guyana class had the exam. You'll find this on page 4. And you know, I had told them to learn these things, and none of these things come. But I suppose every exam is sort of different, right? None of these things come. But what I did, I told them pick out the ones that are easy not, right? So like the hazards, I think somebody's trying to get in. Let me see. The hazards, you can pick out those that are easy, right? So extreme environmental conditions, weather, waves, sea current, temperature, ice, etc. So that's always going to be a hazard. Because remember, it's a floating. This is marine, you know, this part of the class is marine vessels anyway, right? Accelerated wear and corrosion. So that's a nice one. The stress of constant movement, buffeting, and aggressive salt spray means that structures and equipment can quickly fail if maintenance is neglected. We looked at this earlier in an earlier element, which would have been the one on corrosion. Collision with other vessels and structures, including running aground, sorry, and damage from icebergs. But I mean, like, you could actually have like other vessels, like, you know, tugboats and stuff as well, making collision with the structures, right? These may also result in environmental damage, oil spill, and inadequate defective mooring. Combined with extreme weather may contribute to this. We will look at controls of vessel design and marine operation later, right? The intrinsic hazards of the substance, we look at the hazards of the main substances in element one, LNG, hydrogen sulfide, and drilling fluid mud. We also looked at the potential for fire. And so they could have just said that, right? Instead of seeing this, right? So the potential for fire, explosion, these things, of course, are highly flammable, right? So just pick about 4, because remember these questions are like 8 marks. I can probably see 4 hazards, so you can go extreme, and I mean, you could pick what is easy to put, like for you now, right? Collision with other vessels, you have corrosion, you have spills, you have the flammability nature of what it's carrying, and then you have things like what again? Environmental conditions, that's always an easy one. So that's 5, but I don't think you'll be asked 5. Drilling rig hazards, other than those already mentioned, such as fire and substances in use, working at height, manual handling, lone working, personnel falling overboard is a good one always to talk about, right? Through tripping and slipping with the risk of cold shock from icy water, extreme fatigue, the effort to stay afloat, and waterlogged clothing. Hypothermia, if not rescued immediately, and drowning. We looked at recovery, or we will look, we looked at recovery and rescue in the last element. They could have just said what they looked at, right? Instead of putting that line there. So piracy is a big one. I would spend a lot of time on that one in the last class. Piracy. I think there's a little bit more on piracy coming up, right? So a specific problem around East Africa, Somalia. We will look at some aspects of vessel safety and security later, right? So I know there's a little bit of it coming up still. All right. In general, this ship should be securely moored, or you know, sort of, you know, tied or anchored on. The responsible people in charge of the terminal and the tanker respectively should agree a loading, offloading plan, exchange information about cargo, transfer rates, venting quantities, communication signals, etc. A checklist is used for this purpose. For tanker loading operation, this may involve the inspection of the tank and verification of the previous load and tank cleanliness. Ship doors, ports, windows, etc. that open into the tank deck should be kept closed to avoid ingress of flammable vapor and the risk of explosion in accommodation vessels or accommodation areas. Ventilation systems will also have to be adjusted or disconnected, so that they do not suck in flammable vapors or act as an ignition source. Cargo tanks should be protected by flame arrestors. Ship-to-terminal connections, those are the pipeline or the hose, such as via directly connected hose or marine loading arms, also known as metal cargo arms can be fitted with an emergency release. Most of them do have that anyway, right? Unless if you have like an old system set up. Liquid loading lines and vapor emission control lines, vapor recovery should be clearly distinguished to avoid misconnection. This would typically be unique or be unique connection design so that they cannot be inadvertently connected to the wrong line, right? So does it fit up them would fit, you know what, supposed to go where will actually go where it's supposed to go, right? Hoses should be inspected for defects before use. They should be subject to periodic pressure testing. Hose located underwater would require periodic inspection by divers, right? So I guess you can pick up four hazards there, and they do have some controls. But to me, the hazards would be, sorry, the controls would be what the hazards, you know, would be in reference to. So if you say extreme environmental conditions, you may want to talk about maybe, you know, like for that day, letting the, you know, the work sort of subside, or taking care, especially if you have like high waves and stuff, you may want to kind of cancel work on the deck or whatever have you, right? So corrosion, we talk about anti-corrosion properties. We had done that in lesson one. Things like the anti-wetting agents, things like collision. You could have possibly, I guess, good supervision. Maybe have like some sort of warning system to warn of an incoming craft. Right. And so you could have controls, but I think if the axial hazards and controls, I think the hazard would lean to the controls then, right? So they have given a bunch of controls here, but they may have to be for the exam then. I think they'd have to be connected to the hazard, right? Instead of just talking about, you know, ship doors and stuff, you know, should be closed. Right, I mean, but that's if you see that there is a door that is open, right? So, like, I don't see it as just a control; I see it as a hazard and a control, right? If you talk about things like maybe spills, leaks, then you can probably talk about hoses and pipes should be inspected and be maintained in a periodic basis, right? So, that's what I see that as. There is one, so maybe when we are finished, we could take a look at one, right? If you want, you can read this as well. Like I said, it's not much, but by 2 o'clock, I can assess where we are at and I'll stop the reading. The reading is a bit, you know, longer, but we would see a way we can get and just explain the rest of it, right? I may keep reading anyway. I didn't really want to read everything, right? But it's still kind of early anyway. It's just 1:15, right? So the position of the hoses, loading arms should be adjusted to take account of the rising and falling of the ship, so as not to place undue strain on the components, the hoses themselves, ship manifold connections. Wind loading can be a particular issue for marine loading arms and can place additional strain on connections. The weather should be monitored before and during the operation, with the operation being suspended in case of where high winds or electrical storms are expected, right? So that's what I'm saying. To me, if it's 4 and 4, the controls are the opposite to the hazard, right? Crews should keep watch for leaks during the operation and be prepared to stop if leaks are detected. Precautions against electrical discharge need to be observed for electrical discharge between ships and terminals. This is most likely to arise during terminal hose slash arm connection to the ship manifold. So the connection to the ship either uses an insulating non-conducting flange or a length of insulating hose. The ship side and terminal side are then electrically isolated from each other. It has been found that the previous practice of earth bonding the ship to the terminal is ineffective and in fact dangerous in some cases, and so is not generally recommended. See topic focus, right? And that would have been with electrons and protons and stuff, right? That sort of connection or that sort of thing that electrons like to go to protons. In addition, precautions against static electrical discharge, ship side or terminal side should be observed. Right? Many petroleum-based products, is that it there? So many petroleum-based products, do not crude oil accumulate static because they are poor electrical conductors. Precautions during the loading of tankers include inerting, which is with like with nitrogen or Well, nitrogen is most commonly gas, commonly used gas, right? You have also argon. Control of the initial liquid flow rate when changing tanks. Is it changing or charging? Charging tanks, right? And allowing liquid to rest for at least 30 minutes after loading before any metallic equipment or for sampling, etc., is introduced, and only if it is earth-bonded to the ship. Coordinate activities or take precautions if hazardous activities are being undertaken in adjacent tank berths. Do not allow tugs, helicopters, etc. to approach too close during the operation, or suspend operation if they must. Right? And that's because you're doing a hazardous activity, right? So do not really allow anything come close to you. Right? So you could be like emptying a tank or changing out, I guess, from one tank to another. There should be joint formal agreement between the master of the vessel and the terminal authority on readiness to load or unload cargo. No transfer should take place before this. Both sides should monitor the operation and communicate throughout. Right. I could read some of this too, right? And again, some of this could just be explained. Okay, I'll explain some, but okay, so reading from here. Appendix 2, guidelines for marine managing marine risk associated with FPSOs. OGP International Association and Oil and Gas Producers Report number 377 includes a checklist of hazards associated with floating production storage and offloading units, which include, and there's a telic I just picked four, right? So based on the fact that carrying LNG, you could have like, leak of gas and or oil arising from blowouts, pipeline leaks, process leaks, non-process incidents such as fire, chemical spill leaks. You could just pull four and read it, right? Marine events such as collision of supply, standby and support vessels, collision with other vessels, capsizing or grounding, extreme loading due to wind or waves, structural failure due to fatigue, design error, failure of derrick, crane or other equipment, and that could be due to mechanical defect, drop objects during construction, crane operation, cargo transfer, drilling operation, transport activities, crew changes in field or transfers. And this is if you'll see some of this coming up in a bit, if they're being transferred, from, I guess, another ship to your ship, or I guess a helicopter, right? So look right here. Helicopter crash or fire during refueling, capsizing of crew boats or accident to personnel during the transfer. Construction accidents, onshore or offshore work, marine installation, commissioning activities, pipeline, diving accidents, slips and trips. And of course, we are very much familiar with the diving accidents here in Trinidad. So that's too much for an 8-mark question. Pick out four, and you should be good to go, right? Said I don't want to finish too early, right? That's that. After right here, around here is when marine transport stops center. And then we're back on land transport, and land transport is easier. Look at right here. So I'll explain this one. So control of marine operation, certification of vessel inspection and approval. Are there people outside? Oh, I see somebody messaging here. All right, so it's a short paragraph, isn't it? So when it makes sense, just read it out, right? I think I'll just read it out. I'll explain it at the end, right? So you will already be familiar with one of the forms of control for oil and gas marine offshore installation, the safety case regime. This runs in parallel with other regulatory controls on vessels. All vessels undergoing international voyage, like tankers, are subjected to a system known as flagging. It's such a good thing, but no such questions for exam, right? It must be registered in the country and abides by its maritime regulation. As an example, a UK registered vessel, UK flagged, must comply with the requirements of the UK Marine and Coast Guard Agency, MCA. These requirements derive from those of the International Marine Organization or the IMO. Typically, this would mean certification approval. So, depending on the vessel, it would need a certificate of safety construction, oil pollution prevention, and that is because of a convention they have called the MARPOL convention, load line, and that's a nice one to help guard against overloading of the vessel, sitting too low in the water. So they make a load line on the ship. So if you're loading the ship with whatever huge cargo, or I guess, if it was one of those vessels that was taking oil because it have storage tanks on it, they make a load line then. So when you see the ship as you load is going to go down a bit, right? Then you're not supposed to cross the load line anyway. Tonnage. Ship must pay a tax to enter port, and this is levied based on their tonnage. Mobile Offshore Drilling Unit, MODU, safety, compliance with the look it up there, right? The International Marine Organization requirements for the safety of marine offshore drilling units, right? So it must comply with international requirements. Shipboard safety management, the ship operates to a documented effective management system. If you want, I'll explain that at the end. Class, i.e., the ship will conform to established rules on design, build, inspection, and maintenance for that class of vessel. These certificates would normally be issued by independent verifiers called classification societies, right? So I guess a long story short there, but it's often good to get a long story sometime, is that ships must be sort of, like trace back to a point of origin then, right? So, and that process is called flagging. So, if you have a vessel that was from no like from a Norway, or a vessel from the UK, America, Guyana, Trinidad, right? So even though you're doing international travel or voyage then, right? Because you're sort of carrying stuff from one country to another, the ship must be sourced, and that is called flagging. And like where it's registered to then, right, is where the laws it would have to follow, right? So if it's registered to, like, even if it's in Guyana waters or in Trinidad waters, where the ship came from then in terms of its source, right, that is the law that it would need to apply and follow, right? If it follows, the UK legislation, that's some of the things you mentioned here. Right, in terms of health and safety and stuff, you have lots of laws. We mentioned some of them here. We have laws like COMA, to prevent a major spill, all of those things, right? So Trinidad, and you have the international, marine organization standards. So I guess, vessels here would conform to that. But of course, the UK, places like Canada, America, and stuff, they have way much more than just, like the international marine organization standards anyway, right? And to the end here, they just spoke about the ship must be sort of, there'd be certain things you have to pay, and that could be based on the tonnage of the ship, the class of the ship, right? And those, would have been certified then by the classification society as what class of vessel is this anyway, class one, class two, etc. Right. So load line, this is a mark on the side of the ship's hull to indicate the maximum load. It depends on water density, and that could be affected by temperature and salinity as well. It also is, of course, I mean, the most obvious thing is that it's affected by the load that you put in the vessel, right? Let me see what I could say here again. This is a nice one too, folks. Again, just to see what the learning outcome would have been here. I did tell students to learn four of these persons on the vessel, right? But they're not all new, right? I mean, and you'll see that in a bit. They're not all new. We have a marine coordinator, we have a ship master, a ship, sorry, a chief steward, we have a chief engineer, and some of these and not that hard, like a first officer and a second officer. So third officer, right? Deck cadet, able seaman, ordinary seaman. So I told them to learn four. Again, I told you what happened in the October's exam. They didn't have any sort of question, like to identify four key persons responsible for like a marine activity then. And we could talk about transport or loading, offloading, whatever have you. Right. So again, one exam doesn't dictate another, but what I'm trying to tell you too is that these questions are not too common then, right? I've checked, I've not seen too much. I've seen the hazards of the FPSO, which we read a bit of them here. And if you understand what it is, you could just make up those hazards, right? You can talk about working at height, collision with other marine, vessels, right? Corrosion, weather, right? High waves, whatever have you. So I'll still go through them here because I tell you, look, we almost finished, right? Look, this is what we have to do here. After this is one more page on marine transport, and if I explain it, we'll be finished with it. And then it's land transport, and land transport isn't that kind of hard anyway, right? So maybe what I could do, I haven't mentioned some of the positions. We could probably just go into some of them, right? So these are some of the persons here that would be, on a vessel itself, the marine coordinator, the shipmaster. I'll touch them in a bit. I just want you to see them, right? You have chief officer, then you have second officer, third officer, deck cadet, able seaman, ordinary seaman. Not that hard. And like I said, not too much where exam is concerned. I always like the chief engineer, right? That's always a nice one to remember. Marine coordinator, if you look through, you start to see MC and stuff, they would be referring it to as, right? So let me just read a little bit of it. I don't think there's much work in it, right? And I guess that's why there's not too much questions on it anyway. So we have a marine coordinator coordinates all the activities related to the vessel arrival, mooring, cargo loading, discharge, and departure. So how hard is that, right? This is the marine equivalent of a logistics coordinator. Liaison with other functions would also be involved. Example, when vessels require annual or special independent certification. It's a nice one, a marine coordinator, loading, offloading. How hard is that, right? But like I said, questions are not really there, right? A shipmaster or the captain, so you can't get this one wrong, the captain, right? Has ultimate authority and responsibility aboard ship. So don't overlearn things now. Just be familiar with them. Make sure you always know four. I always say make sure you always know four. So that you could answer it if it was to come. But a better question here is the hazards of the FPSO, which we covered just now there. So in particular, he's responsible, he or she is responsible to the flag state, which is the UK or Guyana or Trinidad, right? So they abide by those laws then. Classification society and operator for the continued seaworthiness and safety of the vessel and will have the authority to do whatever is needed to maintain compliance. He or she is responsible for the safe navigation of the ship and the continued safety of the crew and cargo, including from threats such as pirates. In case of incidents such as collisions, pollution, the master or the captain will keep accurate records, log, and provide these and cooperate with investigators. While in practice, the captain will delegate many tasks such as piloting. He cannot delegate the legal responsibility laid down in international marine law or any other law that we have in the world, right? In the UK, especially. The crew is everybody else. They are many different ranks and departments. Deck crew consists of, right? So, if you ask me again for the two of them, I would say no. I would say this probably is not a question. It's a little too easy, but it's good to know four of them now, right? What do you all think, right? The first officer, chief officer, right? Second in command after the master, after the captain. Responsibilities include maintenance of the ship, the integrity of the hull, as well as equipment for the likes of firefighting, supervision and training of the deck crew. So that's a nice way to kind of remember that one. And anything to do with cargo, charging, discharging, and cleaning tanks. Second officer, mainly responsible for vessel navigation, course, charting, etc. And may also assist the chief officer, which is the first officer, in their duties. Third officer, usually responsible for safety, so in charge of the safety equipment. So maybe we could stick to that one. Again, I don't have a passport to go back and tell you. I could tell you what these things look like, right? Deck cadet, essentially a trainee officer. Able seaman duties include watchman and maintaining a steady head at the helm as directed, steady heading at the helm as directed. Ordinary seaman, generally, general duties include painting, cleaning, and helping with cargo operation. Right, we can go back up here. I think I have some up here. Chief engineer, responsible for supervising of the engine room operations and other engineering equipment. There's a whole range of lower ranking engineers, second, third, fourth, who are responsible for maintenance. Steward crew consists of the chief steward in charge of food and cleaning services. The chief cook would report to this rank. So you actually have other people there, like the cook and stuff as well. But just pick four. I would, of course, tell you pick the easy ones, but I'm not too sure what is easy for you. I'll go with the captain. I'll go with things with the chief engineer. Whatever is easy for you, I'll probably just go with, able seaman or whatever have you, right? But it's not to say then that should they ask them what are four responsibilities, then you can get into that, right? This piece here, personnel transfer and boarding arrangement, but have some hazards in this one. You could just watch it and you can see that, right? I don't know if you want to kind of line up with your book, but it's the same thing anyway. We could read this out. So typical methods of personnel transfer and boarding include helicopter, but this depends on whether look what sorry whether location and whether the vessel is fitted with a heli deck. Transfer basket, which let me try to show you it, right? So there are numerous designs, example a personnel transfer capsule, but essentially this consists of a frame of rope of rigid construction. By the way, this is a better one. Inside which or onto which several personnel sit or hold. The basket is transferred from ship to ship using the ship's crane, so you could only imagine. I tell you, they could access four hazards here and four control. And as you pointed out, the controls are kind of the opposite to the hazards, right? So there has been a number of accidents with this type of transfer, and so it is not generally recommended if alternatives are available. Since this is a lifting operation using lifting equipment and greatly affected by weather conditions, it will be subjected to the usual lift planning and equipment inspection, testing, and marking. For example, what would have been the safe working load, right? So you just talk about things like that, like whether a hazard is exceeding the safe working load. A hazard could probably be, maybe a defective latch on the hook on the crane that's carrying this thing. A hazard could probably be, even, I guess, I said overloading already, right? I was thinking about the hazard could have been things like maybe poor construction, maybe it has been used, a used basket, or not a basket that is, but not one like this, that not one of good integrity, right? And of course, the controls would be don't exceed the safe working load. If I said bad weather, then don't do the transfer during bad weather. We spoke about corrosion, make sure it's well maintained, the latch, make sure it's well maintained, make sure there's a lift plan, make sure a risk assessment is done. It's a bit on the easier side, right, than you think anyway. I would, of course, recommend to you all, as you all know, the technique in the last chapter is reading and using the book, but I would, of course, recommend to you all that you all carry a book and start reading it as well in this last sort of days we have anyway, right? Gangways, bridges, and accommodation ladders, the usual means of transit between ship and shore, where a ship is moored at port, right? So a bridge, gangway, right? I guess an accommodation ladder, right? So they may also be used for transit between offshore installation and ships. Bridges can be lifted at short notice if, for example, the weather conditions deteriorates. Rope ladder for pilot transfer. Before docking at the terminal, local pilots may be transferred to the ship to aid in navigation. They will be considerably more familiar with local waters, right? These personnel are usually transferred out at sea from a small pilot boat to the ship via a rope ladder hung over the side of the ship. This is a very common method for any ship-to-ship transfer at sea in the absence of a helicopter. This can be somewhat hazardous, so standards have been developed for the ladders and the transfer procedure itself. Right, so this is the part on the pirates they were talking about. Again, none of these came for exam, right? So security, one additional consideration is security. Vessels and terminals used by the oil and gas industries are hazardous, but also obvious targets for terrorists and pirates. Personnel transfers are therefore restricted to authorized personnel only. The level of security will depend on the assessment of the perceived threat at any time, and protocols agreed between vessels and terminals and between vessels for ship-to-ship transfer. There are three levels of security assessment, level one being the lowest, level three being the highest. In general, terminal will develop a port facility security plan. So maybe that's something to learn. That's the proper thing to say, right? Port facility security plan. Because you want to say improve security, but you know, I mean, I guess Nibosh would want you to learn some of the proper things too. So to cover port to ship transfers, amongst other things, it will include measures to prevent unauthorized access to the port and specific restricted areas. It would allow for shore leave. It would rotate the crew, allow visitors on board. Let me come down a bit. So this may typically be by some form of identification, example, visitor badge access card system, together with enforcement by security guards, port terminals, request information about the ship personnel and cargo prior to entry on the port. They communicate and formally agree the specific security protocols for transfers. All right, let's go to the next slide. So we have personal protective equipment suitability. The nature of the task and its associated risk will determine the selection, suitability, and appropriateness of PPE to be worn. Typical protection worn on board ship would include safety boots, boiler suits, overalls, and gloves, cotton rigger gloves for general work, but also specialist gloves such as a welding or working with chemicals slash oil, and high visibility jackets. Depending on the job, personnel might also require goggles, hearing protection for the engine room, harness and lanyard for maintenance work at height, respirators, breathing apparatus, including emergency escape breathing apparatus. Right? Visor slash face shields for chemicals and those used for welding and anti-static spark proof clothing zips. As an example, for ship transfer by basket, personnel might be wearing safety helmets, inflatable life jackets with light and whistle, and a survival suit for the cold seas, if it was cold seas, right? Diver operation. So diver operation might be required for purposes of inspection, example, of mooring, pipelines, anchor, maintenance, repair, and also decommissioning. Divers can be categorized into several different types. We have surface supplied diving, which the air is right there, where divers have the air supplied via hose from like a vessel. We have self-contained underwater breathing apparatus, scuba, where the diver carries their own air supply in tanks on their back. This gives more freedom to the diver, but has a more limited air supply. A hybrid system, sometimes called mobile or portable surface supplied diving. A mobile system which adds some of the greater flexibility inherent with SEBA, but the air is actually surface supplied, but probably with a longer, a longer sort of, tubing system, if that is what they're using, or they do have to come and refill or whatever, right? So atmospheric diving suits and habitats may also be employed in diving operation. Those are the good ones where you go down with the module, right? Inspection is increasingly being done by remote operated vehicles or ROVs, essentially a robotic underwater CCTV camera rather than divers. Installations would normally maintain a site information dossier or SID, which would assess the likely mutual impact and act as a source of information to dive in or the ROV contractors. And you also have the OGP report, that 411 breaks the diver operation management process down into four steps, right? And we have here, where did it pick up from though? This book is a bit strange, right? I guess we're gonna go in the big head. It's a compliance. All parties must comply with all applicable national or international industry and company contractor requirement for the diving operation. The more stringent requirement should be followed where there is a conflict between those requirements. And that's often the key. If you have two standards, you often go with the higher one. So we have compliance planning. The diving operation should be properly planned, including coverage of such activities as agreeing communication, roles and responsibilities, agreeing the scope of the job, identifying likely hazards and assessing their risks, typically using thorough, detailed, systematic techniques such as hazards and failure mode effect analysis, if that's an FMEA, right, to help identify potential domino effects. And that's from the report there. So the OGP report 411 breaks subsea risk assessment down into three stages. Stage one, onshore risk assessment during the onshore planning stage. Stage two, on-site risk assessments actually on-site and by those supervising the work. This will be more specific than the onshore assessment. So we have onshore, but we have on-site. Stage three, toolbox talks, a communication and review event shortly before the work actually begins, involving everyone who is a part of the job. Stage two and stage three generally include a part of the execution step. See later, I guess. They could just say it one time, right? This is the thing with some textbooks. Divers and ROVs are obviously at risk from operations undertaken on board vessels and installation, but the reverse is also true. Example, a diver may accidentally sever or damage an oil pipeline or block a fire water intake. The risks to divers include drowning, becoming trapped, example, by their own airlines or by mooring, or stuck in the soft or in a soft seabed. Problems with their breathing apparatus, example, faulty valves, all of those things have to be checked before, right? Incorrect gas mixture, loss of gas, developing illnesses during the dive that could still be common, blackouts, developing decompression sickness, normally referred to as the bends, right? And that feel anyway, developing nitrogen narcosis or narcosis, a state similar to alcohol intoxication, developing oxygen poisoning, and that's of course if it's a bit enriched anyway, right? Miscommunication leading to errors, collision if a vessel escapes from its mooring or from the ROVs also being used, the effects of extreme environment, changeable weather, if it's cold or hot or vice versa. But I guess it could be vice versa if it could be close to like a volcano or something like that, right? An underwater volcano, right? Identifying required competence and how this will be delivered, training, etc., and assess qualifications or experience validation, right? So all of that is part of the risk assessment. Again, I guess just take the headings and just take one thing. Compliance, comply with, international law. Planning, you could just say that as just doing a good risk assessment. Like what you may need to learn, of course, I said there's no questions there, is the recommended, like a three-stage risk assessment, right? So on show, on site, and then a toolbox talk. That latter part should be too difficult anyway. Right. So it's often good to learn new information then, but that's one of the things. With the open book exam, you could often open the book and see that, like what you didn't know. But with these exams, you kind of have to learn as much as you can learn or be familiar with it. Like when you read it once, you should be familiar with it, right? The October exam, I was saying, it had a lot of common sense question. right? Things on accident investigation, just things about just general safety, which was actually kind of good. Nothing too detailed, right? There was actually one or two questions like that, but the majority of them would have been common sense questions then, you know, like just hazards in the oil and gas industry. Nothing too specific, but every paper is different, right? Checking that systems, equipment, and vessels are in satisfactory condition and good working order. I'll leave out some of these things, right? But whenever somebody write like this, when they see a book written like this, is poorly written. If you look at the NEBOSH, most of the NEBOSH books kind of get rid of that. When they put two things in one thing, the author of these things should just say it anyway, right? Planning for emergency situations that might arise, right? And they could just see what the emergency situation is, right? Decompression sickness, hyperbaric evacuation, and notification of accidents to regulators as required by law. Management of change or proper authorization. That should have just been in one sentence, right? Execution. Site rules must be followed and developed. Risk assessment stage one and stage two, as discussed earlier, on-site risk assessment and toolbox talks. Safety briefing, induction, expectations, etc. Use of a formal permit to work to dive, to control the dive, to ensure joint planning, risk assessment, management, and communication between all parties. Measuring and improvements, a review of these operations and any incidents and what lessons can be learned so that peace may be the same as any other accident sort of thing. And that's the end of the marine part of it. Now comes the land part of it, right? And it's 10 to 2. So I actually did read, and not if I'd explained and just tell you what the risk assessment was, and we'd have finished since 1:30, but it still is early, right? And the land one isn't that hard either, right? So just to give you an overview, this is the last thing for the oil and gas course. There's two pages you're gonna see on land transport, just hazards and control. And then they actually go into, if you look at it a bit, they go into things like the marking that's on the tank. And that's it. Watch it. That's it, it's done, right? Just like general hazards and control. And then it's done. So nothing too difficult, you know, to end off the course anyway. I think the difficult things may have been up in front, but you can never tell that. I mean, like, this is still a good question, like four hazards of land transport, and that should be easy. It would be actually the same thing, things like spills, like fire, explosion, collision, you know, you could have things like even bad roads or bad weather. It's kind of the same thing, right? All right, let me just start a bit, right? It's actually still 10 to 2, right? So tankers, so sometimes referred to as fixed tanks or road tank vehicles. The tank is permanently fixed to the vehicle chassis. Tank containers, sometimes called ISO tanks or portable tanks, are held in box steel framework. The framework is locked to the vehicle chassis but can be unloaded from the vehicle. This is particularly suited to transfer of tanks between, say, road vehicles and trains or road vehicles and ship. Right? So yeah, the same tank could just be, you know, unhinged then, right? All the connections, you know, sort of, you know, unlocked, and then that tank could be transferred to a ship or a train, right? UN classification and transport of hazardous materials, the transport of dangerous goods. So there's a big law for this, right? In the UK, did I do the wrong thing? I think I pressed the wrong button there. But I know they won't come and ask the name of the law, nothing like that. Look at here. This would be a, just like a mouthful and a brainful to remember. I don't know if you can see. Our degree students, by the way, it's actually referred to as the ADR, so thank God for that. But like, you know, like if you had to remember the name of this, right? The Carriage of Dangerous Goods and Use of Transportable Pressure Equipment Regulation 2009. That is like a brainful team start to remember that, right? The Carriage of Dangerous Goods. Our degree students have to learn it, right? And the Use of Transportable Portable Pressure Equipment Regulation 2009. Thank God, often referred to as the ADR. Anyway, I started back here, right? So Carrying goods by road involved the risk of traffic accidents. If the goods carried are dangerous, there's also the risk that the dangerous goods may escape, owing to the collision with vehicles or storage vessels, or spillage of the goods, including during transfer, leading to the effects such as fires, explosion, injury, death, ill health, and environmental pollution. So that paragraph said it all. They have more than four in it right there. Right? Transportation of dangerous goods has long been a subject, or at least influenced by international agreements. The current rules derive from a system of model regulations developed by the United Nations. These are published as the UN Recommendation on the Transport of Dangerous Goods. Model regulation, often referred to as the Orange Book because of the color of the cover, is supported by the manual of tests and criteria. But the UK have their own laws, and that's what I was turning you here, right? The UK have their own laws for the transport of dangerous goods. In the main, these recommendations have been developed wholesale into legally binding international agreements. They are modal variations published separately for road, rail, air, sea, and inland waterways, necessitated by the operational differences. There are also some negotiated national and regional variations in the application, usually leading to more stringent requirements. So in Europe, international road transport of dangerous goods such as petroleum products and road tankers is governed by a set of rules called the European Agreement Concerning the International Carriage of Dangerous Goods by Road, also known as ADR, which derives from its French title. This is a modal, i.e., just for road in this case, implementation of the generic UN recommendation, national implementation by Europe, by the European state for purely domestic and domestic transport, essentially reference ADR, but with small variations called derogation. For example, in the UK, their own regulation, when they say domestic regulation, right, is the one I mentioned to you here. So in the UK, their own regulation are the Carriage of Dangerous Goods and Use of Transportable Pressure Equipment Regulation 2009, and these allow use of modified markings and placarding of the road tankers. See coming up with the signs and them in a bit, right? So that's the one we normally learn because remember the course come from the UK, this one here. But you know, I shouldn't read all of that history there for you. The point is, it have a lot of laws covering land transport, right? We should have probably just go to the hazards. But the truth is, the first paragraph actually had the hazards. I don't see the accident aid then. That's too easy. I can just see four: fire, explosion, environmental harm, collision with, you know, other moving vehicles. Anybody could think of another one if it's road transport. I could think of a lot, but a lot of them does end in things like fire and death, right? So I don't know if there is any, you know, they mentioned pollution, they mentioned environment, and that does say a lot there anyway. And I can see that as a big four, you know, anyway, right? So dangerous goods are substances and articles containing them that have been tested and assessed against certain criteria and found to be potentially dangerous. When carried, they are placed in recognized categories or classes. This process is called classification. Dangerous goods are assigned to the following UN number or UN classes, depending on their predominant hazard. So, one, explosive substance and article, two, gases, three, flammable liquids, etc., etc., right? I don't know if they'll actually, I mean, it may be good to learn one or two, you know, but you see, this is the thing to pick some of the easy ones, you know, one, two, three, fine, right? One, two, three, right? Unless you want to go into something more detailed, right? So, what is the UN classification? It doesn't have a passport on that, right? So two gases, flammable liquids. So pick whatever is easy for you all. Radioactive materials, seven, maybe a number to remember, lucky seven. You know, infectious substances, right? Oxidizing substances, right? So you will note that petrol is assigned to class three, flammable liquids. Let me see that there, flammable liquids. Yes, that's correct. Taking the European ADR as a typical example of UN requirement for road transport of dangerous goods, it covers the following basic areas. So the European version then of the law would require general provision, for example, definitions, training, safety obligations, the appointment of safety advisors if, dangerous goods have to be carried, classification, what class is it? Right, we could probably come on this side, I guess, right? Dangerous goods list. And this is a good one, right? Effectively, a very large lookup table consisting of a tabulated list of dangerous goods together with their classes, UN number. I'll explain some of this just now, right? Packing and tank provision, i.e., allowable packaging and whether it can be transported in tanks. Labeling, exemptions, quantity, and other restrictions, and so on. The table use codes to refer to the refer, sorry, use codes to refer the reader to other chapters of the rules, such as packing and tank provisions to find detailed requirement, right? I'll just stick to what I have here for now, right? And then I'll see if we can add in anything. So UN number. So that's actually something, right? So a four-digit short code assigned to each entry in the list of dangerous goods, which is essentially organized in UN numerical order. Example, petrol, gasoline, or motor spirits is assigned a UN number of 1203, 1203. The numbers have no systematic meaning in themselves, except that anything starting with a zero is a class one explosive. There is some meaning to the numbers, but maybe they didn't cover that. Stick to the 1203, I guess. Yeah. Well, I'll just stick to what they stick to, right? Because there is meaning to the numbers, and I like I try not to explain again, right? But let me explain as I hear already. Because I think it could be a good question. If it is a question, though, that is not really the norm. But question is like to identify four things on a Hazchem panel. What you're looking at there is a Hazchem panel, right? So I don't know if, I mean, that could be after all of that reading and what this law say about that and that law say about that, right? They talk about placarding here, right? Markings and stuff on the tankers, right? So that I still find as a good question, right? The Hazchem panel that is placed on your trucks or whatever have you, right? This is a degree question, and but they don't ask them four, they ask them about, it have more than four things that these things sometimes have a meaning and stuff, right? So, but I could easily pick out four from here, right? So one of them, I don't know if you meant to write it for you. I mean, these two circle already. Right, but this one here, right, this is actually something from the UN. They were talking about the UN before, right? And the UN number and hazard identification number, but this is actually not, because this is the UN number here, right, 1203, but this is actually from the UN as well. This is something called the GHR, right, the Global Harmonized System of Labeling, which was laid down by the UN. And this is actually the system for, well, not the system, but the label for highly flammable. If you notice this one here, right? You see the flame and it's underlined. That's actually highly flammable. So should they, I should probably write it for you all. In the next thing, the axiom, four things on a Hazchem panel. So the proper name for this one is, I didn't see it, or maybe my eyes haven't caught it yet. Right, seen here UN class 3 flammable liquid, but the symbol and the shape itself, the shape is like a diamond, is something called the Global Harmonized GHS, the Global Harmonized System of Labeling GHS, and that's highly flammable. This is actually one too. I think they give you two because maybe they couldn't put two in the same diagram, so they put one outside here. This is actually harmful for the environment, you can actually tell that. From the pit here, there's like a dead fish and I guess sort of, trees without anything on it, right? So that's one. You can see something from a Hazcam panel, the UN number and the UN Global Harmonized System of Labeling in terms of if it's flammable, right? We have we can pull some from here. The Emergency Action Code, right? We have the UN number, that's 3. It also have, I think, like the telephone number. In the event of an emergency, then like who to call. So you see, telephone number is for specialist advice. You also have the manufacturer of the product, right? So we have here OG Products Limited. That's on the Hazcam panel. It actually have more, but the fact that they have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, then you could foresee this to be, a potential. And please don't mark me in it, because I said like the last exam here kind of went like there was lots more common sense things on it than content, right? Like somebody just said, just what common sense could have passed the oil and gas exam. Because actually one of my the supervisors telling me that he was saying that they didn't have much oil and gas in it, but in every paper is different, right? So if you want, we didn't need to read all of that. We kind of wrap it up there. We can move to the next page if there's anything, right? Because all of this is the same thing. All of this is talking about kind of what I just told you there. Trying to get rid of this marker, right? So whenever you read something, because I mean, we're almost there. It's now 2:03. And I won't read this because we read that already, right? Probably pick up something here on this paragraph, right? Let me just pick up something on this one. So this is again not too hard of a paragraph, right? So drivers of tankers must be fully informed of the dangers of the material carried and the emergency action that need to be taken. The European ADR requires drivers to carry instructions in writing, more commonly known as the Transport Emergency Card or TREM card. Anyway, I'll leave that there. They have to carry that card anywhere with them, like through crossing borders. Then you must have the TREM card with you if it's crossing borders, like in Europe anyway. This is a 4-page instruction, which, amongst other things, describe the nature of the hazardous load and the action to be taken in an emergency. The TREM card must be kept in the vehicle cab so that it can be easily located by the emergency services in the event of an accident or border crossing agents or police or agents, right? The driver and the recipient of the material should have written procedures that set out the precautions that need to be taken during loading and unloading. Fire extinguishers should be carried in all vehicles if substances are flammable or explosive. Earth connection should be used during loading and unloading to prevent the possibility of static spark, and no other sources of ignition, such as smoking material, should be allowed in the vicinity. All right, where bulk storage tanks are used for different substances, there's always the possibility of cross-contamination, i.e., a substance being unloaded from a tanker into the wrong bulk tank at an installation. This can be prevented by strict operating procedures and the use of coupling of a different design for each substance. Well, I think they mentioned that before, right? So if the hose doesn't, I think they have lots of accidents like that. Think of it, right? Like the wrong chemical is fed into a tank, resulted in a massive explosion. I think because of that, they redesigned some of these coupling. I don't know if you know what I'm talking about. There's like a hose that would clamp into another hose. But if it's a misfit, then okay, well, that's not the hose for it anyway, right? But there have been lots of accidents like that. At the same time as well, it is also important to ensure that tanks to be filled have enough space so as to prevent spillage through overfilling, right? And things like a high level alarm or a level gauge or a trip device could assist with that. A lot of times operators may not be too conscious of, tank levels and water, especially if you are a delivery truck or you are, how they mentioned, pumping, like maybe oil and gas from an FSO, a floating storage unit, a pipeline, and the pipeline is good as like going into a tank. Those are the floating storage unit wouldn't really know of your tank levels, right? So there must be some sort of communication, some sort of trip device that would trip off that flow once the tank reaches a predetermined figure anyway, right? I think we are the last one. I mean, to be honest, the biggest thing in this one was actually the discard. That's the most thing I tell students to learn, like discard here, but right? I sort of tempted to stop it and open my past paper, you know. But we'll see how it goes. Mark are giving trouble, right? So you see how fun I tell you, I mean the last part of it is, right? I think I'll just go to traffic management and end it off, right? And that'll probably give me other time to open my past paper too. So traffic management. And I won't read all, I'll read the first, the middle, and the last, right? So on-site. The principles of on-site management of traffic include minimize bends, junctions, steeps, gradient, and the use of reversing. That's if that's possible. Remember, that's not possible in certain countries then, right? Because remember, you were not there in terms of the design of the roads or whatever have you. We talk about terrain and all of that as well, right? But some of these you could control, pedestrian and vehicle segregation. That's a good one. You could separate them with a barrier, clear signage, well lit, wide enough, enforce speed limits, right? So that's nice. This could really be a nice question, right? Design with plenty of space for offloading, right? Let's go to the other side, right? Routes. It goes without saying that not all routes are suitable for vehicles, such as tankers transporting petroleum products. Example, no, narrow roads, weak bridges. There is also the issue of the security threat, terrorism, and theft to the vulnerable load being carried, and it's possible use as a terrorist weapon. Consideration of the security of dangerous goods is a specific requirement of the UN's recommendation, and therefore the European ADR. Routes should be planned to minimize such threats and obstructions. If you could, of course. It's not generally considered a good idea to use the same route each time, predictability. However, although the route should be varied, it should be planned each time. The advantage being that if the vehicle goes off route, it can be detected, especially with the more commonly available vehicle tracking systems. Went too far there. All right, so rail, I mean, like, because it's still from the UK, that's not a weird question, right? One of the degree exams in September had a question on trains, but still the question has always still come down to common sense then, right? One short paragraph, yes, I'll read it all. So rail transport of petroleum products will involve tank cars and tank containers. Modal rules on transport for dangerous goods derived from the UN recommendation, and rail is no exception. In Europe, the implementation is called the Regulations Concerning the International Carriage of Dangerous Goods by Rail, RID. Earlier, we discussed the European law, which is commonly referred to as ADR, taken from a French deviation, right? Discuss the ADR requirement for road transport of dangerous goods and tankers. They are very similar risk for rail. As a result, the requirements are very similar. In general, layout and thrust of the two modal regulatory texts being alike. So that's just a variation of the law then, right? One for land, one for rail. When they say modal, that's what they're talking about. A modal is like a variation of the other one, right? There are some obvious operational differences, and there are greater restrictions than for road, especially where transporting dangerous goods through long tunnels, such as the Channel Tunnel, right? I didn't find that was a good end to the, but that's what Nibosh end the course, right? So that's an end there, right? Of course, you all still remember you all are, part of the last batch of people to hold the qualification. Let me try to share Passipa, but we haven't had time to look at much of them. Right. Can you all see that one? That one is 2017. Can you all see that one? Yeah. There's about six of you all, so you all have to see something, right? Can you all see that one on the
Yes,
screen? I
sir.
just have Roger on screen.
Yes, sir.
Yes,
Yes,
sir.
sir.
All right. Okay, good. So a good idea would be to start, I mean, the exam is December, right? I don't have, let me see the exam. We asked for the exam on, let me see, should be the 4th of December, right? For those of us in Trinidad anyway, right? We'd have to work some other sort of system with those in Guyana at the moment. But for the six of us who are here, the exam will be, I'll have to give you some instructions for that as well. The exam is at the school center then, which is not the office, right? As you all know, during the pandemic, school were closed and then we opened the office in San Fernando. But there was always a school for years and years and years, and the exam will be there. I'll have to give you, if you all know where those of us in Trinidad, Padmore Street, which is where the University of the West Indies, in fact, we use one of their blocks. We use a block of theirs, but for the exam wouldn't be in UWE, right? I think UWE is closed on a Sunday. But your exam is a Wednesday. So, but UWE is still closed. I think because of the pandemic, a lot of classes kind of went to online anyway, even with UWE as well. Folks, I lost the I don't know if you all can see it still, but I whatever I did, I sort of, I lost the view of it. So I guess what I have to, I don't even know where it went to. I'm gonna stop the view. Let's see if I could find it back, right? I have a lot of stuff open on the screen now. So can you all see it still? I all still see in the, I don't know what I did with it. It's not on my view screen.
I'm not seeing
No, sir, I'm not seeing it.
Yeah. Let me look. There. Okay, I think I got it. Let me see how to share it back with you all now. Yeah, so they could, like I said, the exam is at that center then, right? For those of us in Trinidad. It's a working day, isn't it? It's a day we have to probably take some time off. Because the exam is 9:30 to 11:30, right? So just have a look at, we'll probably just pick one of these questions here because otherwise we'll never finish anything. So let's just do the first one, right? So the first question, so time management then, right, is of importance, right? So to pass the exam, you have to get 45 marks, which is not hard to get. The first question is worth 20 marks. So I'd advise you to do the first question, right? For the exam in October, the first question is really nice. It was an accident investigation, which to me didn't really relate to oil and gas that much, because what they asked was just general questions anyway. I saw two repeat questions. There was one on the fixed roof tank hazards and control, right? So a technique for passing exam. Where did the Zoom bar go now? A technique for passing exam is kind of looking at the paper and planning out your answer, right? You could do the questions in any order. And what you all have not experienced, so maybe I could probably have you all experience it, is writing in class. And that's difficult over Zoom because you all don't normally have your cameras on and I can't see what you're doing. But a problem that you'll face is that the exam is only 2 hours long. So what I did in Guyana, I had the guys and them write right there, like 20 marks would translate to be 30 minutes. You have 30 minutes to do this question, half an hour, right? And you literally had to speed write, or because it's not a typed exam, you have to write with a pen then, right? They give you like a booklet, like the old-fashioned days, anyway, CXC days, and you have to write. But when they had about three or four go at it, and you all have had none, because you're on Zoom. That's not an excuse though, right? Maybe I said next week, I'll move to have next week off. But maybe the other week we could sort of time it. But would you really stop if we say stop? And would you really put on your camera if we say put on the camera? Right? But when we did it, they kind of understood then that half the battle is the exam content and the other half is the time, right? Anyway, not to talk too much. Let's try the first question, right? So they have here, and when I say try, because you all are not really doing it, which means you're not really trying it, right? So a newly constructed oil and gas installation is due to be commissioned. The installation includes large vessels and long lengths of pipework connected with bolt flanges and gaskets that need to be leak tested. The leak test involves using nitrogen gas to pressurize the vessel and pipework internally to a certain pressure, and then operators spraying soapy water solutions on the outside of each flange or gasket connection. Large flanges gasket leaks result in a loud screeching gas release, and small flange and gasket leaks are extensively visible with the formation of soapy bubbles. So they have here for party outline risk associated with the leak testing operation, right? And that would have been 10. So that's a tough 10, right? And then control measures that could help to reduce risk with the leak testing operation. So yeah, they get 10 different answers then, right? As it have some answers here, so we could take it from here. Of course, some of the more common ones I could think about is nitrogen they're using, right? So remember, nitrogen replaces oxygen and whatever have you, and it could actually, in the presence of nitrogen, then somebody could have breathing problems, right? So for every one that you highlight, and that's a tough thing with it. You have to give, like, everyone have to be about 2 to 3 lines long for it to be an outline, right? And that's tough. And as I said, you're sitting there and saying it's tough is not tough unless you have a chance to write it, like the students in Guyana, to experience what they're talking about, right? So yeah, they come up with 10 of that, and yeah, they come up with 10 controls fast, right? And that is really the challenge in passing these kind of exams. And these are good news is for every hazard you think about, you can think about our control, right? I could think of some others. If they say soapy bubbles and stuff, we could talk about slips and trips could be the risk of slips and trips could be as well one of those hazards. Anybody could think of one? The leak tests involve using nitrogen gas to pressurize the vessels and pipework internally to a certain pressure. Then operators spray soapy water solution on the outside of each flange gas connection.
Well,
Large,
we talk about nitrogen, so if you think about application due to the fact
right?
which part is located at the leak, with the soapy water they're mixing it, it's like you could wherever it is, it could mix with other contamination and could cause something else.
Okay, that's a good one. I put slips here. I did mention somewhere here, loud screeching. So I'll put noise, right? And the one that Stephen mentioned here could be, let me find a word to describe that. But like other reactions then, right? I mean, soapy water bubbles, it's kind of correct there, right? You could have, it have words they have in it. It have words I want to tell you, but I don't know if to tell you. It have words like additive. An additive is like, well, you mix something with something and it ends up being worse now, like 1 plus 1 is 2, right? So that's an additive. So maybe that's the word we could use, like an additive reaction, right? It have other words. It have a word like synergy, synergy or synergetic reaction, where you mix something with something and it turns out to be 1 + 1 is equal to 100. How? Because the two chemicals you mix end up being a worse off, like 10 times worse than the two chemicals you had before. If you want to take that down, that may be a good thing here, an additive reaction, right? Or a synergetic or synergy reaction. Anyway, post again later. It has some answers there, so we can read that. And for everyone now in the part B, you'd recommend a control, you know, maybe a JSA, maybe air defenders for this one, you know. But the point is though, it's 10 and it's not 5. Let's try to get 5. What the rest of you all see? Anything else? A leak testing involved using nitrogen gas to pressurize the vessel. So I could think about, because it would pressurize the vessel, I could think about probably having an explosion, like overpressure, the risk of overpressure. So I got some of that from here. The loud screeching is noise, right? The soapy water is slip strips. You see, the book didn't really help here. What I was gonna put overpressure here, overpressure and explosions. I came up with 5 already, and I'm not even thinking. But then too, if you really had to write fast, you probably don't have time to sort of think too much. It says pressure, right? P-R-E, the R get mixed up here, right? P-R-E-S-S-U-R-E, overpressure leading to like an explosion, right? But there is a challenge, I can tell you, talking about it and doing it to something else, and you would see. But I hope, you know, I mean, I hope we don't wait to see it for the exam. Right, but you could understand that, then that's a big challenge for the exam. In fact, a lot of people, let me show you something, a lot of people with these exams don't finish. A lot of people don't finish, and as I tell you, it's about a technique. You have to try to get that 45. So if you know you do number one, that is 20 marks, right? And you just do what you can do. Hopefully, you learn these things: lower flammability limit, upper flammability limit, right? So if you do this one, that's a 8 marks there. So that is 28. It's which one you do, right? I just said maybe this one look hard, but it's not hard. And these are an easy question. The components of a fire triangle, right? It's a very easy question. Don't let the diagram frighten you. But I just said, right? I just said this is an easy one from last week. Where's active and passive? So that is 28 and 8, that's 36 marks so far. So let me say you leave out number 3. You can do them in any order. Safe shift handover, easy. Right? So this is number 36, 36, and 8. This will give us 44. One more question and we pass. So let me say this is a hard one. You leave out that one. Let me say that's a hard one. You leave out. This is not hard, by the way. Right? And you did this one here, ELARP. That's a nice one. So we have 41, 44, and 8. That will give us 52. And you pass already. So that's all people. This one. Oh, by the way, I think the same question come back. The other question on contractors. Selecting contractors. Remember we did that? They wanted 8 documents. The exam was kind of common sense, I'll tell you. But the trick is, folks, you're listening. The trick is, you see the open book exam? The
Yes,
open book
sir.
exam. Yeah,
Yes,
the open book
sir.
exam. Yeah, good. The open book exam may have spoiled you all a bit, right? What you have to do with these things is you have to plan your questions. Like you have to watch all the questions. Don't start number one and you didn't see number 11. Because number 11 could have been an easy one. With these kind of exams, you had a plan and you had to kind of just try to get your marks as fast as you could. Right? So some people, when they come out of the exam room, I'm just making up this doesn't have to be. I think the same question came back to, right? But I just like some people say, well, you didn't do number 11, and then somebody say, well, maybe reach number 11. You didn't have to reach number 11, but you had to watch all the questions and just do the ones that you can do, right? Contractor questions are often easier. The last question is normally easier, and they're trying to build up your questions and they're trying to build up your mark, right? So what I'm trying to tell you is technique. You don't do it in order. You might not be able to finish, but the thing is, you can still pass, right? Because you're trying to get 45 marks to pass. The ones that you think that you could do, go and do it. The ones that, you know, like the common sense ones, a lot of these things are common sense enough. Do the ones that are like a overall common sense questions then, right? If there is something, you know, that is more core knowledge then maybe, and you didn't study that, just leave that, forget it. You'll come back to it, right? In the last 10 minutes if you finish all the ones that you did and you check your mark and you see you get 60 marks. You could come back and just try maybe part A or part B of it, right? Not all questions are hard. Like this one with the fire, I tell you, none of those questions hard enough. When you look at it, they look like it hard. But when you watch this then, right? This is just common sense. One mark, one mark, one mark. Right? We could still try something, and that one mark may be the difference between 45 and 40. Well, 44, right? Let me just read the answer here for you. We are running out of time as well. All right. Response to part A will limit it. I don't understand why, because they ask hazards and everybody can make up a hazard for that. Hazards questions are the easiest question because a hazard is whatever have the potential to cause harm. So you can never get it wrong. Right? Responses to part A were limited, although candidates did outline the risk signposted in the stem of the question. Anyway, that's the old way of setting questions, right? They used to refer to the question as a stem, and the question had a key and it had a distractor. So that's just Nibosh talking about how they set the question, right? Though this is not a real stem they're talking about, it's just something in the question itself, right? Of the question, including asphyxia from nitrogen, hearing damage due to the leaks, candidates would have gained marks or outlined in general issues, including the effects of heat, cuts and bruises due to sharp edges, and ergonomic injuries, assessing awkwardly located flanges. That's a nice one. I didn't think of that one, right? Some candidates simply listed their responses, which you know they don't give you a mark. That's throwing away answers. If it's a slip and trip is the answer, but you have to outline it. You have to say, you know, like there's a risk of slip and trips and the workers walking on the pipeline and applying the soapy water. Their feet may make contact with the pipe and thereby slip. Better put it in a sentence, because if you put it as just a word, you'll get it wrong, right? Hear the noise, it could have said noise could affect the hearing of the workers due to the loud screeching on a positive test for a leak, right? So some candidates listed their responses instead of providing an outline as specified in the question, limiting their marks. But what it really means is that they don't really give you any mark, right? Several candidates incorrectly focus on risk associated with the leak testing equipment and the risk of excessive pressures within the pipe work. Well, we're not going to focus on it. We're just saying that is one of the hazards leading to explosion, right? We're not focusing on the excessive pressure. Answers to part B were also limited, which again, I don't understand why, because if you give the hazard, you could have just given the control. Candidates did outline control measures of permit to work for leak testing, suitable personal protective equipment of hearing protection. Few candidates outlined the need for suitable lighting levels. That would have been a good one. Candidates would have gained marks outlining other general issues, including waterproof sheeting and suitable housekeeping. Some candidates incorrectly focus on control measures associated with the leak testing equipment. The question sought to extract understanding of the generic risk and control measures of carrying out leak testing of flanges in a large oil and gas installation. Candidates' responses reveal a lack of understanding in how this common task is carried out practically in a vocational setting. So maybe you could read up on it a bit. This was not too long ago. I mean, 2017, but I mean, that's long ago, come to think of it. But, you know, they have repeated questions, right? So you see the head shaking, right? It's not like the open book exam, they don't repeat. But with these exams, they repeat, right? Like sometimes they could get three, four questions repeated. Imagine if you get a number one repeat like this. And you actually went and do the work and didn't just listen to me giving you five, right? Then you'll be ready for it. As opposed to saying, I remember doing it, but we just get five. But what about if you go on and get it done? Right? I finished there for today, right? So we did actually wrap up. I actually do have. We miss Wednesday. Imagine that we miss Wednesday and we still finish. And as I was telling you, I didn't want to do Wednesday because I know it's going to finish. I actually have the space for one more on the register now. How we had done it? We're supposed to have one more class, but we are finished, right? Wednesday, I would not have any classes. I mean, I don't know if Wednesday, I'm actually flying back into Trinidad Wednesday evening. So that's probably the main reason why I don't want to have class. And Sunday I don't want to have because I haven't had a Sunday off in a long time. But maybe the other Sunday we could come back and have a writing exercise, or the other Wednesday we could come back and have a writing exercise, right? So I'll kind of liaise with you. I mean, I don't mind the Wednesday where I give you a question and you write it, but the only problem is how would we see it over Zoom? You'll have to probably read it out for me. I wouldn't choose a long one like this, or even this paper. We could choose one from the recent paper and give it like an 8-mark question and tell you to write out the answer for it. So begin your studies as much as possible, because that would be the only way I think again to make it meaningful going forward anyway, right? I did mention to these past papers that I'd sent to you all, you could probably run through them. I didn't see the one in the floating roof tank here, but they repeated a floating roof question. I didn't see it on this paper, which meant it had to come from, like, if you run to 2017, 2013, like the four past papers I think you have available, you'll get a repeat question or two. The question is, would you be prepared for it, or would you just say it is a repeat and I didn't do it? Right? So that's the trick with it. You have to kind of be familiar with the older papers. They kind of give you some answers. That's why I had favored the older papers. The newer papers don't really give many answers anyway, right? Folks, let me stop this recording.